How about 5 years ago? Did you work or live in Brickell? Okay, we've got a few more. 3 years ago? No, the 10 people, the 5 people still should raise their hands. We should be getting, the number should be increasing as we go. And then how many people have only been living in Brickell, I guess, or working in Brickell for a year? So, I mean, I think the demographic is changing. I mean, what a difference 10 years can really make. And if you think about our city and our downtown area, if you look at the south side of Brickell, 10 years ago, 1450 Brickell and 1 Broadway weren't there. Alan Ojeda was kind of crazy at the time for doing a rental building and an office at the south end of Brickell. We didn't have Echo, we were being built right next door. The north end or the northern end, the DuPont was just being demolished and turned into the Epic, the Sheridan Wall. The north end extends to the Biscayne Corridor and some new fun place called the Upper East Side. I don't think anyone thought that would ever be in Miami. It would probably be only in Manhattan. And we've also moved west. We moved west. The river. The river was popular about 10 years ago as well, but now really we've moved west, South Miami Avenue. We heard people talking about things like Alapata, which I don't think was in anyone's vocabulary 10 years ago. Someone I'm sure will figure out how to move east, but you know, that's a little difficult with the water. We have Panoramic Tower and 1000 Museum. We've got buildings called Armada and Austin Martin under construction. We didn't have 600 Brickell. We didn't have the Espirito Santo building, which is now called the Brickell Arch. And we certainly didn't have the Wells Fargo building. We didn't even have the Bankers called Wells Fargo in Miami. We didn't have international restaurants like Zuma, Koya, Cipriani, Cantina La Viente. They just didn't exist, they weren't here. And the hotels. There was no SLS, no Aton. No one knew what the East was. They thought it was a direction. No Kimptons, no Hampton Inns, no Alofts. I'm talking about Brickell and downtown. We've got a Hyatt coming down on Jerry's project. We didn't have the Marriott Marquis. I mean, this is all just in 10 years. Mary Brickell Village was just finishing being built. Brickell City Center didn't exist, and there was no Publix. Now there's about 10 of them. And also, there's no such thing as Miami Central, Miami World Center, the Science Museum, and Pan. Pan was something you cooked with. So, I mean, we really, really have changed a lot, and it's only been 10 years. So we need to give ourselves a lot of credit for that. So I'm going to turn it over to three of our panelists right now to talk about their projects. The two things that always seem to hold true for real estate is vision. Developers need vision. They can't copy what the last person did. They really need to kind of be out there. In addition to vision, they need a little luck and some money. But the other thing we know about real estate is that it's cyclical, and the industry is always changing. So Jerry, Lewis, and Nitin, each of you have major projects under construction. Why did you pick the particular location that you did? The uses that you have for that project? That's the first part of my question. And then the second part, what I want to get into, is you each broke ground at different times, but you're all currently under construction. Okay, how has the market changed since you started construction? Jerry's looking the other way.
There's a lot of parts to this.
I know there's a lot of parts. I'll break it down for you. Why did you pick where you picked and the uses? You have a rental building. Everyone else was going condos. You went rental. You put a hotel in there. You lease the hotel. You have medical office. You have funky amenities, cool amenities.
Well, first of all, at the time, if you go back even years before, my father likes to say at 5 o'clock he used to roll up the sidewalks. There was nothing going on. There was Brickell had a little bit more cachet as a commercial center. And then you mentioned all the things started to fill in. We started to get the condominiums being built. There were some more people moved in. That meant that retailers would really take a hard look. So you got the restaurants, you got the Publix. That was as commonplace as that sounds, that was a huge thing for the Brickell area. We got one Publix, you got two Publix, then you got a retail center. So it became the type of urban area that we wanted to build in, because it provided everything in a short area. So you could walk to it, you could walk to your restaurant, you could walk to your retail, you could walk to your market. And it became that high density live work play that we had been striving for. And you know, I sit on the DDA with some of our families here, and I can tell you we've been striving for that for 30 years. And you can't, obviously the public sector couldn't do it alone, and they had to have the private sector meeting. So we just felt that Brickell was right for a project like ours. So we would provide a place really in our project if you wanted to, but if you could experience the whole neighborhood where you could live, work, and play. Plus it had the his neighborhood, not Brickell, but also downtown and the Park West area. They're all sort of within walking distance now for people who live in there. And now it's a wonderful place to live. We have people coming to us that say, you know, I'm not even going to bring a car. And I say, listen, I built all these spaces, you're not going to bring a car.
All of our young associates live on Brickell, and none of them own cars. It blows my mind.
And you know, I think, you know, we look at mass transit, one of the nice things about our downtown rural area is all the mass transit and proposed mass transit all sort of terminates here. And then you've got the last mile that's being proposed, which we heard, the automated cars, the Ubers, the trolley system, those are all last mile features. So all the larger mass transit, it terminates in Miami at the government center, and then it's easy to get everywhere else from there.
No, thank you. Louis, you went ultra luxury on the Biscayne Corridor. 10 years ago, Biscayne Corridor, people really weren't building there. Explain why you selected that area and why an ultra luxury condominium.
Well, after the market had collapsed and there was really no activity for, you know, we had a period of a few years where there was really nothing being in that area. And when we started to see life again in the market, and we started to look at the market, we recognized that there was something a little bit unique going on, sort of in the Brickell downtown area. The units that had been built in the previous cycles were small. Most of the units were, I think the average unit size we looked at, it was somewhere in the 1,100 square foot range. And what we noticed was there was two things going on. Related was starting to now sort of ramp up its pipeline. At that time, when we first started looking at the 1,000 museum site, I think Related had probably announced by that point maybe 12 projects that they had on boards, which probably grew to about 20. And we didn't, when we looked at the site, what we noticed was, and you looked at the whole downtown market, there was a very small percentage of inventory of units over 3,000 square feet. But the units over 3,000 square feet were actually selling at a premium to everything else in the marketplace. So with our site, you know, that site is a T680, basically, you know, about the highest density you have in the corridor. It virtually unlimited height, only limited by the FAA. You had density of 500 units to the acre. If we had an acre, we could have put 500 units on that site. But what we didn't want to be was in a position that when the market plateaued and started, you know, it cycled like they always do, the markets move up, the markets move down. We didn't want to be in a position where we were sitting with a 500 unit project competing against Related, okay?
Fair enough.
It's not a good position to be in Miami, especially in the condo market. So we took a very different path. We were paying up for the site. We paid at the time what was probably the highest price per acre for a piece of land in that area. It would probably only to be eclipsed by the Epic site, you know, where Aston Martin's plant. And we needed to do something different. So we went complete contrary, and we said we're going to build big units, very boutique style building, but we're going to build something very, you know, as big as we can build it and iconic. Obviously, we went and looked for, you know, who was probably the top architect in the world at the time, and we, you know, got her to, you know, design the project, and that's the path we went. And so far, it's actually proved to have been a good path because, as we know, the market has sort of slowed down a little bit. Inventory is getting absorbed. It's happening. There's a lot of projects that were planned that are going to, you know, not happen as soon as they had been planned to happen. That'll actually help the supply as things get absorbed. And you know, Miami will continue to do what it's done, which is each time there's been a cycle, the next cycle seems to create new highs from the previous cycle.
So being chairing is a good thing, and I have to say the building is really fabulous. It really stands out on the skyline. So congratulations. Nitin, now you went in a completely different direction as well. You kind of went more towards a underdeveloped, I'm going to use a politically correct term, more underdeveloped, not as much notice or as much popularity in the area where Miami World Center is. How did you pick that site? Why did you pick that site? And how did you determine the uses?
So our customary business, we run a private equity fund and we build projects all over the country. We buy, build, sell. And so it's pretty typical. This was a unique opportunity for us to aggregate a large amount of land right behind the Zaha D building. And the reality for us was, in looking at all these great cities around the world, we knew this site would be the confluence of arts, culture, entertainment, and transportation. So you mentioned a lot of the amenities. The Art Center had just opened, the American Airlines Arena became relevant because we won our first championship. But then on top of that, you had the Perez Art Museum under construction, the recently opened Science Museum, the improvements happening in the Bayside Bayfront, the port's continued growth. And then we had great relationships with Fortress, the parent company, to all aboard, and knew they were in fact moving forward with the privately funded rail. Couple that with the Marlins Stadium, and now what will happen with Beckham Soccer Stadium, I mean, that's $9 billion of investment that were happening around us, forgetting about what we were doing. And we also looked at the fact that, you know, with the previous panel talked about transit, and Jerry and I were saying, if this county and city and state could afford more transit, it would work. That's the reality. It's money that is slowing us down because the demand is clearly there. And we knew that all modes of public transportation would end up attaching to that Grand Central Station or Miami Central at a time call. So being next to that public transit, we knew was a great long-term bet. We also knew that people won't get out of their cars anytime soon, so having the ingress and egress off of 395 and 995 directly onto site is a huge opportunity for the area. And you see that on Brickell where it gets choked up and it talks about now doing a tunnel over the Brickell bridges or figuring out how to get to I-95 so I don't have to go through 10 blocks, which is 10 hours of wait. We don't have that. We actually are getting the signature bridge, which will improve the ingress and egress. So when you think about long-term, you're surrounded by arts, culture, entertainment, and then transportation, both public and private. So we had good bones. We worked with the city, county, and state at that time to get the port tunnel, which got 300 trucks an hour off of our streets. We worked with Camilla's House to move to their new location near UM. And that gave us a chance to own 27 acres, next to 15 acres all aboard of them. And together we planned 45 acres in the middle of a downtown. You just don't get that privilege in a lot of places. And so we have all of the uses. So with Paramount, our condominium, similar to Lewis and his team, we took more of a contrarian approach. We said average unit size still crept up to 1,100. Our average unit size is 1,700 square feet. But what we were able to offer more so than anyone because of the land we own is all of our parking garages are covered by amenities for Paramount. So Paramount has a 4-acre amenity, right? So Icon has a 2-acre amenity deck for 1,800 units. Paramount has a 4-acre amenity deck for 563. So as a result, we're outperforming sales in the market. June was one of our better months. We have buyers from 42 different countries. We have over 40 different amenities. You just can't offer that anywhere else. We're also doing apartments for rent. And Forrest Taubman are doing the retail with us long-term. And MBM is doing the convention hotel. Zahm is also doing apartments. And Heinz recently announced an office building with the thesis being that they delivered the first Class A office, which is still, you know, 30 years later, one of the top in the state, but just sold for the highest price that any building in Miami and Florida has ever sold for. And it's 30 years old. So these guys know what they're doing, and they're building an office of Miami World because of the ingress and egress, because it's hard to get in and out of the world. 1450, where your office is, you know, benefits from that. It's an easier building to get in and out of. So our uses are across the board, from convention hotel to office, for apartments to rent that average 800 feet, to condos that are 1700 feet, to retail that runs the gamut, a lot of food and beverage.
Yeah, so I think it sounds like, to sum it up, all three of you had vision, and a long-term vision. It wasn't a short-term vision. Some of it was international flavor. Some of it was what really is the heart of the city. And because of sometimes the contrarian approach or just having this vision, that these short-term market changes aren't really impacting where you're going or what you're doing. It sounds like all of your projects are not really impacted by the short-term financing. You all have financing. You all are moving full steam ahead. So I think that answered part of your question. So thank you. Alicia, I'd like to turn it over to you. You know, as Jerry said, you know, Brickell always had the panache, it always had the brand. You know, it was Miami, but Brickell. The international buyers really love Brickell and that brand. What are you seeing today? Like, what does your customer want? Like, where do they want to be? Is it still Brickell? Is it now more downtown? Where do they want to be and why?
What's interesting, you say Brickell always had the panache. So we go back 40 years.
It did, but it was single family homes.
So I think one of the things that our firm takes pride in, we've been in business, we're ramping up for 50 years, and we've kind of been at the forefront of pioneering new neighborhoods. So I remember when Brickell was a new neighborhood because people in Miami lived in single-family homes, and then we went south of Fifth when people thought it was crazy, and why was I going to that ghetto known as south of Fifth where there was, you know, a drug addicts and whatever. And then I did something really insane and went to sell One Miami in downtown that hadn't seen a high rise for 20 years. And as I like to say, I had the privilege of growing up in a city that grew up with me. So for us, when we talk about East Edgewater or the Upper East Side, it's a very natural progression. And it's absolutely logical, and as Nitin said, to be able to put together that many acres in the middle of downtown Miami. Well, to be able to have that many streets with direct frontage on the bay, as is the case in the East Edgewater neighborhood, is an unbelievable privilege that most major metropolitan areas like ours don't even dream of. And we are such a privileged city because not only do we have the natural beauty and the availability of land because we're such a young city, but we have this unbelievable influx of capital that just can't seem to get enough of us. So I think that the East Edgewater neighborhood is a huge opportunity for people who want unobstructed direct views all day long, with also good access because we have great access not only to the beach but to the airport and therefore the world. But you also have great opportunities in places that are more established. And when I think of real estate today, my fun thought is I used to sell Miami saying, oh, it's so nice to park and you can drive everywhere. I know I'm about 150 years old. And now I think to myself, oh, it's so easy to walk, and who wants to get in a car anyway? And so we're experiencing that. And clearly, as the three gentlemen up here have proven, if you have vision and you create a project that's special, it works. And we're certainly experiencing that with a project like Aston Martin, that when I sat down with ownership and I was talking about Miami and the cycles and the ups and the downs and everything that happens here, and I tend to be very conservative, and so the owner looked at me and he says, Alisa, you do know that I'm going to build my building. And I said, oh yes, and when are we going to start selling it? And it became clear to me that our city had matured to a point where the developers are not nervous about building and selling their buildings. They are obviously concerned about how long it's going to take. But we have the big boys, and they're still all boys, who come up and are committed to building the building, and not unlike models in most of the country, they're not relying on dollar for dollar in sales. They're coming fully funded, as in the case of, for instance, water, with Brickell City Center. You know, they just said, we're gonna build it. And I'm seeing more and more of that, where a real commitment is made on the part of the developers, and of course, our buyers are showing up with real capital. And it's showing signs of a city that is much more mature, much more filled in, has proven that it's resilient, and that continues to grow at a staggering rate. So when people talk about the market right now and how it is, and is it slower, and is it this, it's certainly calmer, I would say. But if you compare it to most metropolitan areas, if not all, in the country, we are still on a stampede mode because things are still selling, they're still moving, prices are holding, people are coming. And the whales, as I like to call those big boys or girls, that come in and buy those multi-million dollar units are here. Yeah. So it continues to be very exciting.
I totally agree with what you're saying. I mean, I think that this slowdown or whatever people are talking about, it's very gradual, and there are these big, very well-established projects that are very well-funded with very sophisticated developers moving full steam ahead.
Yeah, Nitin talked about a great June. We also had a great June. And we had a good absorption on our less expensive product and some major sales in our penthouse inventory. So I think it was exciting.
So as we mature, you know, density obviously becomes a big factor because there's not a lot of land left. People are saying all the land's gone to the condo developers, and people are being creative and looking at places to build other things and other types. Ronaldo, can you talk to us about, I mean, there's the anti-development crowd and there's the development crowd. Why is density, and the former panel talked about density a little bit, but why, from an architectural standpoint, and everything that you're designing, why is density a good thing for a city?
Thank you. So I think density is really not something that we need to be concerned about with regards to quality of life in particular. And what the narrative of Miami has become proves that. I think that, of course, it's a young city. So we're always talking about transit and the fact that we're not investing enough in transit, and that we're underutilizing opportunities for transit-oriented development, like Andrew noted in the previous panel. But I think in general, what I see, which is a pleasure for an architect, is to see the level of quality in this particular cycle being elevated. So I think density requires good quality, requires good amenities for the neighborhood. We talk a lot about parks and about places for us to enjoy. I noted earlier in my introduction, I think, you know, living in Brickell and having my office in Brickell and having experienced the last 20 years of growth in Brickell, it's a great lesson, you know, and it's memorable because, you know, even when we did Infinity at Brickell, that neighborhood was still not there yet. And now you see SLS next door as a good neighbor, and you see the dynamics, the retail, the restaurants, the nightlife that comes with all this millennial youthful living that we have. We have like the youngest inhabitants of urban Miami, about 85,000 people living in the sort of neighborhood that we call downtown Brickell. And I think, you know, the projects that Lewis is doing and the commitment that Denton and the Hollows have shown to the area is fantastic. And I always sort of say density only comes when visionary developers, you know, persistently invest and commit themselves to developing these projects. And of course, as an architect, it's a pleasure, you know, to be in a context where design matters, you know, where Lewis decides to bring Zaha Hadid to Miami. I mean, this really elevates the level of expectation of the market, and it challenges us local architects to really do better work, which is fantastic. I mean, we also do work in Dubai and other markets, but in this particular market, I've noticed that design matters and quality matters. So I see that in these new projects, and I think that's very important.
I think that goes to the maturity of the city. And then, Jared, did you want to say something?
Well, just again, on the complexity issue, it goes, and you touched on the quality of life, it goes to, but for the public sector, it goes through efficiency. And I think they need to embrace that a little bit more because they're able to service a lot more people and a lot more businesses with far fewer resources. I can tell you that for the city of Miami, our district, where we are, probably generates 25, 30, maybe 40% of the ad valorem tax revenue for the whole city of Miami.
That's amazing.
And for the county, it's a lot less sewer system they have to maintain, a lot less domestic water, a lot. The efficiencies in this type of density is amazing, and I think they need to embrace it more, and I think they need to. And we keep touching on it, transit. They need to push transit now. Circulating is so important for that type of density, and that'll help all these areas thrive.
I also think that density creates wonderful opportunities. I too am on the DDA. One of those opportunities is to develop access to our waterfront, which we had turned our back in the city. So we've got great opportunity to do things like the underlying is where density people are going to use it. That can connect to the Riverwalk, which can connect to the Baywalk, and create this horizontal linear park, if you will. And we couldn't do that if we didn't have the density because there would be nowhere to go. And now it's just one continuous Champs Elysees on Biscayne Bay.
Very well said. Only you can say that. And with a smile, I'm very elegant, for sure. But it does, it creates a sense of energy and excitement. As I said, all of our young associates live downtown or on Brickell. None of them have cars. They all Uber around town, and they live, work, and play, just like you said, Jerry, downtown. I mean, it's all about downtown Brickell, whatnot. So I want to turn, did you have somebody to say this? You want to add?
Yeah, just on the density issue, I mean, look, development is always not popular. You know, it's certainly not always popular with people that are living in an established area. You know, they have this mentality of, well, I was here first, and there shouldn't be anyone that should be able to, you know, move in next to me. But the reality is, look, there's two alternatives. All these things we're talking about, you want to improve transit, you want to improve infrastructure, all these things cost money, okay? So there's two options of how to raise this money. You can allow development, okay, and in a sense, have the developers help pay for this. We can raise people's taxes, okay? Raising people's taxes is never popular, okay? So if you look at, you had a choice between allowing more development through higher density to generate those revenues for a city or raising taxes, I think most of the people would probably opt not to have the taxes raised. So, you know, you really can't have it both ways.
Good point.
Last thing to that, Suzanne, I'd say that density is often misunderstood. And Andrew Frey, the previous panel, mentioned, you know, putting it into context for Little Havana. We created what ended up becoming a special area plan where if you aggregate enough land, you can play with your density and move it around. So in the end, what we're ending up with is, yes, Paramount's a big we think, a big, beautiful tower, but we have a lot of open space on the ground level. We have two pedestrian streets that we're paying for, we are maintaining, two parks that we are paying for, we are maintaining. Because we can move our air rights around, it gives us a little flexibility. So sometimes, you know, I think density should hire a VCO to handle their marketing, because the phrase is a bad, sometimes gets a bad reputation when it's actually a very positive. I mean, when we think about, we turned our backs to the water, we turned our backs to the Metro Rail, we've done a lot of bad development in this community, and we're finally doing a lot of great stuff, and we should embrace it and give developers, with partnership with the city, we have a great planning director, the flexibility to work out, try new things.
Andrew's point was spot on. I mean, increase the density, create affordability. People can't afford to live here.
You know, when you look at it, I mean, look, developers are taking risks. They're risking real capital on projects. They're not going to do things that don't make sense. So,
here we
go.
Last night. It's like
a
better plan.
So we decided at 500 units at the acre density. Okay, we only built 83 units because that's what made sense for our project. What happened to those other units we didn't build? Okay.
Good point.
Someone should be able to build them.
Very good point. Jerry?
Well, there was one other thing we were talking, what's nice about the area too, because of the maturity, and it was touched on before, we're able now to attract some incredible architecture to this area. You've got Hadid, we're working with Foster and Partners, you've got Rem Koolhaas to look down the area, although not specifically in this district. So it's really, architecturally, and I think you can say it, we're really growing up. It's not necessarily the square, the rectangle buildings anymore. There's real interest in these towers and these structures that are themselves becoming almost like art pieces.
Right, and complicated to build. I mean, it takes a lot of creativity. I mean, Lewis's project is incredibly complicated and expensive to build, but it's really fabulous. Let's turn the topic a little bit to the press. And the press, everyone likes to take pot shots at the real estate developers and the real estate industry. It's always doom and gloom if you read the press. It's never good. We've got condos, we've got retail. Retail seems to be the latest problem child. But when we were all talking, I mean, retail seems to be a great driver. I mean, Miami is kind of out of this retail implosion. We've got luxury under construction. We've got everyday neighborhood retail under construction. Retail seems to be driving some of our residential projects. Do any of you want to comment on the impact of retail in Miami and this phenomenon, maybe why we're different than everywhere else?
Well, I think we have the luxury of demand. Right. And I think that distinguishes. Now, there's going, like everything, there's cycles and there's bid asks that change. So, you know, all those great $400 a foot rents on Lincoln Road probably aren't, the last five deals, I would assume, aren't $400 a foot. So the market changes, but there's plenty of people that want to be on Lincoln Road. There's plenty of people that want to be in downtown, whether it's with us, whether it's with Brickell, whether it's Wynwood Design District along the Biscayne Corridor. There's no shortage of demand at the right price. So that's where the equilibrium will occur. There's a lot of cities, and that's where the press, looking at the macro level, will focus, where there is no demand. So it doesn't matter what you charge, no one's going to fill those empty spaces. So there is the Amazon effect. You can blame it on a variety of different ideas. But as long as there's great cities with heavy traffic and international being a big part of that, which Miami benefits from. And so, you know, when you walk down Fifth Avenue or Madison Avenue, their vacancy rates are a lot higher than ours down here. So I think there'll be some, you know, bumps along the road, but there's not going to be this huge concern that the media loves to pick on Miami for whatever reason.
And developers and the retail industry.
Yeah, well, we have fixed it, so we're doing it. But I'd say that in general, and it's important. I mean, I think
we
closed almost $500 million in debt in the last 6 months in Miami World from various different product types. It's amazing when an article is printed how you get a call from a lender or equity partner. Wait, what's going on? I just read this article. Could be completely factually incorrect, but it does have a negative impact, unfortunately. Now, the good news is, and this is what we're spending a lot of time at the DDA, another shout out to the DDA, we do a lot of research and reports because we found that a lot of the information out there was not correct. And when we get the data and information out there, we're finding tremendous interest from a variety of equity sources, lenders, buyers of property. And so across the board, Miami has certainly matured. And hopefully the media will give us the benefit of the doubt.
But I think a good point is not just the data, it's the spin, it's the Alicia of the world, you know, explaining the data. Because people don't understand that. It's just a bunch of numbers. Alicia, did you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I also
think that Miami was completely shopping impaired. We had nowhere to go shopping. I mean, if you worked in Brickell Avenue, and you know, which happened to me every week, and I had to go somewhere afterwards and couldn't make it home, I mean, Rick Rack, God bless them, which is a salon, had a rack of clothes, and I'd walk in there and get dressed in the salon, but there wasn't anywhere where you could go buy anything. So I think in the retail world, we had a lot of catching up to do. And just now, when I go to Brickell City Center, I went there the other day thinking I'd grab a quick bite. Quick bite? There was 30-minute waits at almost every restaurant. It was insane. I couldn't even believe what was going on there. So it's a huge driver, and people are getting out of their cars and want to walk. We're selling flat iron, and people love the fact that they can walk to Brickell City Center, and they love the fact that they're not living in Brickell City Center. So I think it's a driver. I think at one point, Steve Owens said George Perez loves Brickell City Center more than I do, as he bought all the land around him, because people love the accessibility and the opportunity that gave. It also gave us a big push in Vaughan, because people wanted to just walk out their door, go to cafes, and they may be ordering from Amazon, but we're meeting our girlfriends at Saks.
Oh, without a question. The guys, they all laughed, and Alicia made the comment about the outfit, but it was totally true. You guys don't know, you have khakis and a navy blazer, you can go anywhere. Jerry's laughing, but it's true. Jerry and then Renato.
You know, despite itself, we've created neighborhoods here, right? So you had the offices, you didn't have anything else. Then you came in and we built the residential, but we didn't have that what they like to say, the third leg of the stool. Yeah. The third leg of the stool, the retail. So you've got whole neighborhoods built with zero retail. So it had to get filled in. And so you're seeing lifestyle centers come in now, but you're also seeing neighborhood retail in there as well. That there was nothing. I mean, tailors, dry cleaners,
CVS,
all those things. I mean, it had to happen. And now, with the maturity, all that retail's coming in. I mean, we're creating these neighborhoods, mixed use, and all that's coming in and on these mixed use high density projects, because you can't build a residential or the office without the retail.
I also think that the retail is part of the densification narrative, and it's a necessary ingredient to really have a successful, walkable, lively downtown. So, and I think what's key is to kind of design the retail with adaptability and innovation, so it changes through time. You know, if you look at European cities, you know, retail centers around Paris or Madrid or Barcelona, they're always changing, they're always adapting to the market. I see people opening up restaurants in Brickell where you have primarily millennial group that millennials cannot afford to go to that restaurant. So, you know, you've got to be smart about what you bring, where you bring it. Brickell City Center certainly is a game-changing place for us in Brickell. Nobody mentions Brickell Village anymore, but that is also there and is active and is lively and is leased up. So there's a variety of different types of retail, but it's a necessary ingredient. And I think what Burlington Group is doing in Little Havana with a lot of local flavor, you know, we're using a lot of the word curating retail nowadays. And I think that's necessary, and I think the press sort of misses the long-term perspective of how cities evolve and how lively they are, and Brickell is super lively right now. When I opened my office in Brickell, there was like maybe one place I could go for lunch. Now there are about 30 places, and it's very walkable.
All right, so vision, live, work, play, retail, amenities. We're gonna talk a little bit about amenities. We can't lose sight of that. I mean, we've got helipads, we've got wine storage rooms, we've got dog walkers, we've got everything you need to have a fun, exciting, life. Schools, we have schools now too. We never had schools. So you pretty much have everything now, which is fabulous. We're really kind of rounding ourselves out and actually maturing, I think is really a great way to put it. So I've got two speed questions just to kind of wrap things up, and I'm just gonna go down the line with all the panelists. I'm gonna start on the end. So in your opinion, what project is or was the biggest game changer in downtown and Brickell in the last 10 years? I think I'm gonna know your answer based upon what you said earlier, but.
Yeah, so I think the vision that Steve Owen had with Brickell City Center is really amazing, because you know, he brought the right mix. I'm really into mixed uses, and I think that's wonderful, because you have the retail, the office, the hotel, the residential, all these things combined and sort of focus with quality. I think that's fantastic, so I think that's very transformative. I think what Quinton and his group are doing in that part, what we used to call Park West, and now it's a better name, New World, is fantastic, and it takes time, you know, so you have to have like a 15-20 year vision to see how that will transform the neighborhood where Lewis is also doing this iconic tower. So I think that there are a lot of game-changing things. I think that Miami 21, our zoning code, really stimulates a lot of this. And I think that we have a great planning director. I think what we're doing now is to work with the city to make sure that what we're building is also sustainable and resilient, because we do understand that the world is changing and that we need to build smarter in the way that these buildings will adapt, you know, to a changing water world, as some people call it.
Well, okay, so speed round means you gotta answer really quickly because we're running out of time. But no, I distinctly remember someone in the paper saying that Steve Owens was simply crazy with the amount of money he paid for the vacant land during the downturn, but now he's obviously a genius. So, Lewis, what probably the biggest game changer?
I actually think that the cultural center that was created is really the catalyst project or the start of sort of the downtown redevelopment. So if you look at, you know, it started with the Performing Arts Center and then moved into Museum Park and the museums and the arena. I mean, the creation of that whole area to create that sort of district, you know, for entertainment, arts, and, you know, even to some extent, I know there's been a lot of, again, a lot of negativity about it, but, you know, the creation of the entertainment district on 11th Street, I mean, that was a big catalyst for the redevelopment of downtown. And eventually, who knows how that will develop over time, you know, what that'll look like 10 years from now. But, you know, we were, you know, when the Performing Arts started, which is probably, what, close to 20 years ago, 18 years ago, something like that. I mean, that was the, what I see as the beginning of, you know, probably a 20 or 25 year sort of cycle in downtown. And, you know, we're past the midway point, you know, so the momentum is there. And I think, you know, a project like Miami World Center to be able to take that amount of acreage and aggregate all of that and actually have an opportunity to reshape a whole portion of downtown will help then push development even further west, where you can get this redevelopment over town that everybody's looking for.
Nitin?
Yeah, I'd say it's a Miami Central. You know, just by the end of this year, we'll have trains running to Fort Lauderdale and Palm Beach, eventually Orlando and all the cities in the Tri-County, coupled with Metro Mover, Metro Rail, and hopefully eventually a system that takes you over to the beach and also connects up through all of the new neighborhoods, Edgewater Design District, Midtown, Wynwood. So I think that longer term, people will look back and see that as a big game changer for the way people commute.
I agree. Jared?
I guess I'm going to cop out because I think you've heard that there is no one thing that sets an area away. It's everything. It's the will of the people, the will of private sector to build good projects, and it's the will of the public sector, or again, that's private pushing the public sector to recognize the importance of other types of projects, cultural or transit oriented. So there's, I don't think you can say there's one thing, especially in Miami, because it's so spread out across what's been important. You've heard retail has been important, you've heard cultural is important, you've heard transit. So it's all those things.
But I think maybe to sum up what you're saying is really that whole concept of live, work, play and making that a reality.
Right.
That's really the game changer.
Certainly.
Alicia? And I, at the heart of all of that, which these men have eloquated so well, are the people. I think it's the people of Miami that are the most important component of Miami. And again, we're so blessed because we're constantly getting an infusion of new talent, exciting talent, new capital that is greeted by the most welcoming community on the planet because we are so generous, so open-hearted, intellectually, financially, with our opportunities, with our private organizations, with our public organizations, that it's all of you and all of us that make all of this happen. So I think that really is very transformative for our city and continues to be. Agreed, all great answers. All right, one last question. You know, hindsight's 2020. If all of you could look back in time, 10 years, 10 to 15 years, what is that, and money's no object at the time, what is that one thing, piece of land, building, what would you have bought that you could have bought that really is exciting? What, go ahead, let's hear.
Anything that's for sale.
I can say anything on the
water. No, wrong.
I can say anything on the water.
Anything, the closer to the water, that it's better, but you really couldn't go wrong if you bought anything that was for sale, period.
Jerry, anything you wish you would have bought a while ago?
I think there's too many.
There's too many things, okay.
Too many things.
Nick?
We tried the land on Biscayne adjacent to our property, one of which Lewis has, because we felt that we create a lot of value for those sites and they are Bayfront. But unfortunately, money is an object. And people thought we were crazy enough for what we were doing, and you go and ask for another $100 million, it was difficult.
And then at the time, you were crazy, but vision, it all goes back to the vision. Lewis?
Actually, we were involved early on with the Nittman Art buying land by New World Center. And then when the things changed, we were like, guys, we're out. I wish we had not sold some of the things that we sold as opposed to what we didn't buy.
Fair enough.
Well, I would say, because I'm not into buying land, that the one thing that's going to really change the game of downtown in the next 10 years is the Miami Center project, the section that is illustrated in this pamphlet that everybody has. That's an amazing section, because that would be a place to reconnect through the Tri-County up to Orlando. And that is something so new, publicly funded, stimulated by the private sector, which I think is the future of transit. And I think it's super innovative, and it's going to really change the character of the neighborhood significantly in the next 10 years.
I totally agree. Well, could you help me in thanking our panelists?